In the HBO series Boardwalk Empire, his name was changed to Nucky Thompson. But the character is loosely based on a historic person. His real name was Enoch Lewis Johnson, his nickname Nucky being derived from his first name Enoch. Nucky was born on January 20, 1883 in Smithfield, New Jersey. While still a child, the once barren offshore island, which was to become Atlantic City, was already in the midst of being transformed into the resort town we know today. During the early 20th century, Atlantic City's boardwalk was extremely popular, especially on Sundays. A photograph taken on Easter Sunday in 1905 reveals what it was like to be a part of the boardwalk's crush of wall-to-wall people. To Nucky, Atlantic City was his kind of town. He held various positions of authority in both the city and county government. After his father stepped down as sheriff in 1908, Nucky was elected to replace him. As Nucky ascended in the ranks of political power, his brother Alfred would later become sheriff. In 1909, Nucky became secretary of the powerful Atlantic County Republican Executive Committee. After Lewis Cunnell, you know him as Commodore, was convicted on corruption charges and imprisoned, Nucky succeeded him as boss. At least that was the allegation. Nucky's trademark was a fresh red carnation he'd pinned to his lapel daily. Town folk noted it was rare to ever see Nucky without one. He reportedly did business from a ninth-floor suite in the Ritz-Carlton Hotel, handing out political jobs, favors, and goods to local residents in exchange for money and political support. The character on Boardwalk Empire shares many similarities with the real Nucky. However, there is little, if any, evidence that the real Nucky ever ordered anyone killed or did the deed himself. In 1906, Nucky married his teenage sweetheart, Mabel Jeffries of Mays Landing. By all accounts, the marriage seemed happy. But tragedy struck in 1912 when Mabel developed a cough she couldn't shake. The diagnosis was grim. Mabel had contracted tuberculosis, or what was commonly referred to as consumption. Determined to do whatever he could to help his wife, Nucky accompanied Mabel to a sanitarium in Colorado. Her stay there was brief. 3 weeks later, Nucky and Mabel were back on a train to New Jersey. Only Mabel was in a coffin. With the passage of the 18th Amendment, which came into effect on January 17, 1920, and the subsequent Volstead Act, prohibition became the law of the land. But you wouldn't have known it if you had traveled to Atlantic City. Folks there, they just pretty much ignored the law. Reports filed by prohibition agents at the time noted, Nucky Johnson, who became the virtual dictator of Atlantic City, protected those engaged in the manufacturing, selling, and distribution of the illegal hooch. And what a good business it was. Many town folk ran their own stills, selling it to just about every major city on the East Coast, even as far away as Chicago. And Nucky? He got a piece of the action. If a customer wanted the good stuff, Nucky and his crew would have it imported from Canada, Ireland, Scotland, and England. Champagne, anyone? We have contacts in France and can get it by the boatload. In his book, The Last Good Time, Jonathan Van Meter noted, Atlantic City had become the headquarters for the nation's most notorious rum runners. Rum Row, some 30 miles offshore, supplied the entire country with its hard liquor. In and around Atlantic City, a fleet of trucks would pick up the liquor from wherever it came ashore and hauled it to the distribution warehouses. When asked why he ignored prohibition, Nucky Johnson replied, "We have whiskey, wine, women, song, and slot machines. I won't deny it, and I won't apologize for it. If the majority of people didn't want them, they wouldn't be profitable and they wouldn't exist. The fact that they do exist proves to me that the people want them." Nucky cemented friendships with other bootleggers throughout the country, but his closest ally appears to have been Arnold Rothstein, known throughout New York as Mr. Big. Years later, after Prohibition was repealed, agents disclosed that Atlantic City's activities weren't just protected by Nucky Johnson. The Treasury agents quickly realized that local law enforcement not only were well aware of these conditions, but actively regulated, protected, and at times even assisted these rackets, and that this fact was well known to the public, who understood that the racketeers were paying for protection. Based on hearsay, they determined that the horse rooms had to cough up $160 a week, while numbers banks paid $100 a week, and brothels paid $50 a week in the winter and $100 a week in the summer. It was also understood by the public, reported the agents, that none of this graft went to the police officials themselves. Everyone knew it went to Nuck Johnson. Many would argue that prohibition, be it forbidding alcohol, drugs, or gun ownership, will never work. Making something illegal doesn't change the root problem, their behavior. Nucky Johnson, who was the boss of Atlantic City for 30 years, built an empire based on that fact. As long as prohibition was the law of the land, he and his friends were happy and their wealth and power continued to grow. In 1927, Nucky agreed to participate in a loose organization of other bootleggers and racketeers along the East Coast, forming the Big Seven or Seven Group. He was the host of the Atlantic City Conference in 1929, a meeting of national organized crime leaders, including Al Capone and others, in which many historians believe was the first meeting of the emerging national crime syndicate. But much to the chagrin of mobsters throughout the country, prohibition didn't last. It was repealed on December 5, 1933, and the nation celebrated. Now that the country was wet, many hoped that bootlegging gangs would simply dry up. But it wasn't meant to be. They already had made their money and had massive amounts of capital from the sale of illegal liquor, and they simply went looking for new areas of vice with which to invest. Nucky went back to selling political favors for cash and votes. He continued to protect the gambling dens and the whorehouses in the area, and he made a mountain of cash. His lifestyle was extravagant, to say the least. While being investigated for tax evasion, the government found that during the years of 1936 to 1939, Nucky's recorded annual expenditures included $5,000 for rent on a suite at the Ritz-Carlton, $2,200 for a New York City apartment on Central Park, $3,000 for clothing, and $3,000 for food, with lobster, caviar, and 3-inch steaks being featured on his daily menu. By 1935, Nucky owned 4 new model Cadillacs, and at the same time he also had in his employment a valet, bodyguard, 2 chauffeurs, and 3 maids. In May 1939, after an extensive federal investigation, Nucky Johnson was indicted for income tax evasion. The trial took place during the month of July 1941, and Nucky was found guilty. On August 1st of the same year, Nucky married his longtime girlfriend, Miss Florence Osbeck, a 33-year-old showgirl. Nucky, who was 58 at the time, was 25 years her senior. The very next day, he was sentenced to 10 years in prison and fined $20,000. He entered Lewisburg Federal Penitentiary on August 11th and was paroled 4 years later on August 15th, 1945. He took the pauper's oath, basically declaring he was broke in order to avoid paying the $20,000 fine. But many believed this was just a ruse. Still, Nucky was pretty much finished in Atlantic City politics. He stayed in the area, and for 20 years he and Flossie lived on South Elberon Avenue. They later moved to Venter City further down the island. He worked on and off in sales during this time, for the Richfield Oil Company and Renault Winery. In 1961, Nucky announced that he was writing his memoirs. He planned on calling the book Boardwalk Empire, and according to reports, had finished about 400 pages of his life story. He died at the Atlantic County Convalescent Home in Northfield, New Jersey on December 9, 1968. He was 85 years old. His remains now rest in a mausoleum at Zion Cemetery in Bargantown, New Jersey.